Thank you, sir. Now the next we have Dr. Swaranjit Kaur Gill, DM Nephrology, Consultant, Pragma Multispeciality Hospital, Bathinda. And the topic is Management of Urinary Tract Infections in Primary Care.
So very good afternoon to all the audience present, and my special thanks to organizing committee of MEPICON Bathinda and Dr. Vittal Gupta in particular for this privilege. So topic that I have been given to speak on is management of urinary tract infections in primary care. So my topic would kindly demand the audience to suddenly shift their attention from high profile vascular diseases like CVA and pulmonary embolism to low profile dormant bacterial infections. And another disappointing thing is there is no new development in the management of UTIs in the last few decades. So what I am going to do is refresh what you already know about the management of UTIs. So we are going to discuss this topic under these headings with a particular attention about few terms like what is significant bacteriuria, what is asymptomatic bacteriuria, when it should be treated and when not, how do we manage the recurrent UTIs with a particular attention to the urinary tract infections in pregnancy, and few slides about the management of upper urinary tract infections. So UTI, as we all know, is a symptomatic infection of urinary tract. It may be urethra, bladder, ureters, or without involvement of the kidneys. So UTIs are the commonest bacterial infections seen in the primary care, and these are the commonest bacterial infections for which the antibiotics are prescribed. So why the topic of UTI? There are many studies that have shown that management of UTIs in the primary care is many a times inappropriate. Appropriate diagnostic tests are not employed to diagnose UTI. Many a times, more than required number of urine cultures are sent. A second choice of drugs are often used, which are unnecessary. Longer than required treatment courses are given to the patients. And many a times, irrational medications are used, so which is not required. Treatment and diagnosis and management of UTI is very simple, and many a times we complicate it at the level of primary care. So this table shows the prevalence of UTIs, and we all know the prevalence of UTI is far more common in females in the all age groups. And this prevalence is higher in the females of the reproductive age group, and then the prevalence rises after the age of 60 years in the postmenopausal females. While the prevalence is much, much lower in males of all the age groups, in males, the incidence of UTI rises only after the age of 60 years, and this is because of the prostate enlargement, which leads to urinary tract obstruction after the age of 60 years. So there could be two routes of infection of UTI, and by far the commonest route is ascending route of infection. 99% of UTIs are caused by ascending route. The most of the uropathogens are common commensals in the gut. So these bacteria, they migrate from the gut to colonize the periurethral and the perineal skin. And colonization is defined as asymptomatic presence of bacteria in the periurethral and the perineal skin. So colonization is a very common phenomena. After colonization, whether the UTI will occur or not, it depends upon the balance between the bacterial virulence factors and the host defense mechanisms. So whenever the bacterial virulence factors override the host defense mechanism, colonization is followed by the UTI. So UTI also has whenever there is uropathogens, they enter into the urethra and they attach to the uroepithelium, then they ascend into the bladder, then there is an inflammatory response by the host. So combination of these two factors leads to symptoms of the UTI. So hematogenous spread of UTI is very, very rare, and it is seen in less than 1% of the cases. And the anatomic short length of urethra in females is clearly responsible for high prevalence of UTIs in females, and also association of UTIs that is seen with the sexual intercourse. So the causative organisms, we are all aware that the most common uropathogen that causes urinary tract infections, accounting for 80% of the cases, is E. coli. Escherichia coli causes 80% of cases of UTI. Second most common cause of UTI seen in the community acquired infection is the Staphylococcus saprophyticus. This is the common pathogen seen in the females, young females of the reproductive age group. And the treatment of this is gram-positive bacteria, so treatment of this type of infection is different from the other type of UTIs. While these less common organisms like Klebsiella, Proteus, Pseudomonas, Enterococcus, these organisms are mostly responsible for the complicated form of UTIs and the hospital-acquired urinary tract infections, while majority of the community-acquired UTIs are caused by either E. coli or Staphylococcus saprophyticus. So this table again shows the type of uropathogens according to the type of UTI. Most uncomplicated UTIs are caused by E. coli, while complicated UTIs are caused by either resistant E. coli or Pseudomonas acinetobacter. Catheter-associated UTIs and recurrent UTIs are mostly caused by the Proteus mirabilis. So whenever we see in our outdoor OPD, whenever we encounter a patient of urinary tract infection, we need to classify whether the patient is experiencing a lower UTI or an upper UTI. So lower UTI is infection of urethra and bladder. While then whenever there is involvement of the kidneys, we label it as upper UTI, which is also known as pyelonephritis. So both lower and upper UTI, they are further classified into complicated versus uncomplicated. So if we label a UTI as complicated, whenever there is some kind of structural or functional abnormality of the urinary tract. So both lower and upper UTI can be either complicated or uncomplicated. So what are the conditions that label UTI as complicated? So any patient who is having an indwelling catheter is labeled as having complicated UTI. UTI is occurring in a patient with diabetes mellitus, all type of UTI are considered as complicated UTIs. Any UTI in male gender is complicated UTI. UTI occurring in a child, any boy or girl at an age of less than 12 years of age is considered as a complicated UTI. UTI in the presence of renal failure, in the presence of renal stones, if there is any history of urinary tract surgery, UTI occurring in a pregnant female is a complicated UTI. So UTI in the presence of voiding dysfunction, like patients who are having neurogenic bladder dysfunction, which may be either congenital or acquired due to spinal cord injuries, these patients are considered to have complicated UTIs. UTI in any patient who is on immunosuppression, like transplant patients, these are complicated UTIs. Or any type of congenital anomalies of the urinary tract, if UTI occur in its presence, it is labeled as a complicated UTI. So we have to take care whether UTI is happening in the presence of these predisposing conditions, then it is not a simple UTI, then it is labeled as a complicated UTI and treatment is altogether different. So symptoms we all know. UTI might present with a broad range of symptoms. Patient may be totally asymptomatic, and this term is referred to as asymptomatic bacteriuria. Patients who have a lower UTI, they have typical local symptoms, like they present with severe painful micturition called dysuria, urgency of urine, frequency of urine. Patients who have cystitis, they have suprapubic pain and discomfort. And one-third of the patients with cystitis, they may present with gross hematuria. So UTI is one of the differential diagnoses of patients who are presenting with sudden onset gross hematuria. So gross hematuria does not always caused by some urological problems. UTI is one of the important differential diagnoses of gross hematuria. So those patients who have an upper UTI like pyelonephritis, they always have systemic symptoms. So if a patient is presenting with local symptoms and along with fever, chills and rigors, a flank pain and tenderness, then it points towards involvement of the kidneys and patient is likely to have pyelonephritis, and again the treatment plan in these patients would be different. So uncommon presentation of UTI which is seen in elderly and catheterized patient is sudden change in sensorium. An elderly patient who is on a perurethral indwelling catheter the only presenting symptom of UTI may be the sudden change in sensorium. Patient might not be any having any fever, no symptoms of dysuria or supraorbital discomfort. Patient will present with sudden delirium. So any elderly patient on catheter presenting with sudden delirium might be having a urinary tract infection, not necessarily any neurological diagnosis. So diagnosis of UTI is very, very simple. It is based on classic symptoms of UTI with the help of urine microscopy, and urine culture is not always required for diagnosing UTI. So patient who has classic symptoms of UTI and urine microscopy reveals more than 10 WBCs per ml of the uncentrifuged urine or more than 5 WBCs per high power field of the urine sediment. So we have to see in the urine analysis if it is done on the urine sediment or if it is done on the uncentrifuged urine. In uncentrifuged urine, we need more than 10 WBCs for diagnosing UTI. In a urine sediment, we need more than 5 WBCs per high power field. So symptoms of UTI plus findings of urine analysis, these two things are sufficient to diagnose the case of UTI without any report of urine culture. And another thing is pyuria is not always specific for cystitis. I'm going to discuss later what might be the other causes of pyuria. Another two important tests that we can use for diagnosing UTI, these are the dipstick test for nitrites and dipstick test for leukocyte esterase. Nitrite test is basically based on a reduction of nitrates into nitrites by the bacteria which are present in the urine, and these are detected by dipsticks. Majority of the uropathogens that cause UTI, they convert nitrates into nitrites, and the test may be false negative if it is a UTI is caused by the bacteria which does not produce nitrite like Streptococcus faecalis. And another important factor in which test will not be positive is if patient is unable to hold the urine for a period of more than 4 hours, because patients of UTI, they have a symptom of urgency, they frequently void. So they are unable to hold the urine for a long time. So if they are not holding urine in the bladder for the long time, the test may be false negative. So positive nitrite test indicates presence of more than 10 bacteria per ml of urine. And another test is called leukocyte esterase test. And this test is based on the release of leukocyte esterase. This is an enzyme released from the lysed neutrophils. Any patient of UTI has abundance of neutrophils in the urine. And sometimes when the urine analysis is delayed, the neutrophils get lysed and the urine microscopy is false negative. So this advantage of this leukocyte esterase test is that even if the urine microscopy is negative for the pus cells, the leukocyte esterase test will be positive, because even if the cells are lysed, the enzyme will be released from these cells and the test will come out to be positive. So false positive test can be seen if there is vaginal contamination of the urine. So if we combine these two tests, they carry a very high sensitivity and specificity for diagnosing a case of UTI, and they carry a very high negative predictive value. Both these tests are negative, chances, 98% chances that patient does not have a UTI. So urine culture, although we consider urine culture as a gold standard for the diagnosis of UTI, the important thing that I'm going to highlight here, that the routine use of urine culture in primary care and outdoor setting is not recommended. In any patient of UTI, uncomplicated UTI, we need not send the urine culture. We can treat the patient without urine culture. So it is not required for the diagnosis and treatment of urinary tract infection. Why? Because it increases the overall cost of treatment. Number two, treatment is started empirically even before we get the results of urine culture, and treatment is completed even before the culture results are available. So culture is practically unnecessary to diagnose and treat UTIs. But there are few conditions in which culture is recommended. Whenever there is suspicion of upper tract involvement, if there is any suspicion of pyelonephritis, we should send urine culture before starting the empirical antibiotic therapy. If patient does not respond to the antibiotic course, then we have to send the urine culture before changing the antibiotic. In those patients who are experiencing recurrent episodes of UTI, in any patient who is having a complicated UTI, and for the purpose of surveillance of the causative organisms and for study of the antibiotic resistant patterns, in routine outdoor practice, urine culture is unnecessary. and patient can be managed empirically. So few words about the significant bacteriuria. This term was coined by Kass in 1956, and the purpose was to differentiate contaminated urine from truly infected urine. So while collecting samples of urine, contamination is very frequent because bacteria causing UTI are frequently present in the periurethral and the perineal skin, and urine samples frequently get contaminated. So presence of bacteria in urine does not always mean infection. So quantification of bacteria and differentiation of the type of bacteria is very important to find out whether patient is having a true infection or not. So significant bacteriuria, this is how we define significant bacteriuria or a positive culture in a male or a female. In female, we require two consecutive midstream urine samples, and they should be having a colony count of at least 10^5 per ml of urine. While in men, single culture is sufficient, single culture with a colony count of 10^5. And in a patient which sample is taken with in and out catheterization, only 100 CFU per ml is considered as significant. So this is the definition of a positive culture. And there is light modification of significant bacteriuria in females who have symptoms of UTI. In women who have classic symptoms of cystitis or urethritis, in these patients, urine culture with a colony count of 1000^10^4 are also considered as positive cultures, and these females should be labeled as having UTI and they should be treated with the antibiotics. So results of urine cultures are not very simple to interpret, and they should always be interpreted in terms of what was the method of urine collection, if there is any contamination of the urine, if it contains a single bacterial species or if it is a mixed sample. If there is a mixed bacterial colonies, then most likely it is a contaminated sample. What are the results of urine microscopy, if there is any associated pyuria or not, and what is the clinical situation, if patient is having symptoms of UTI or not. So cultures should be interpreted in all these contexts. So there are few clinical conditions that mimic UTI. Particularly in males who are having chlamydial and gonococcal urethritis, they will be having classical symptoms of UTI. They might be having symptoms of dysuria and frequency of urine, and urine microscopy will reveal abundance of pus cells, but the cultures will be consistently negative. So these patients need to be differentiated from UTI, because management of gonococcal and chlamydial urethritis is very different from that of bacterial UTIs. And in females, vulvovaginitis caused by candida and trichomonas may be confused with UTI. And careful history taking helps to differentiate this vulvovaginitis from UTI, because these patients will typically have external dysuria, which is caused by passage of urine across the inflamed labia. They will not be having typical dysuria that the patients of UTI are having. They will have external dysuria. There will be no frequency or urgency of urine. They will not be having any suprapubic discomfort, and they have additional symptoms of vaginal discomfort and vaginal discharge. So careful history taking helps to distinguish patients of vaginitis from cystitis. So another common syndrome which we frequently see in the OPD is acute urethral syndrome. Many a times we see female patients presenting with typical symptoms of UTI. They have classic symptoms of dysuria, frequency, and we are unable to identify any cause of this dysuria and frequency. Their urine examination is perfectly normal. There is no pyuria. Their cultures are repeatedly negative. So far, no cause of this syndrome has been found, and no treatment has been found for this syndrome. There are many causes that have been postulated, some non-specific inflammation of the bladder, muscular dysfunction, or some psychological origin of this syndrome. This may be due to allergy or cold weather, some anxiety, stress, trauma, and in elderly females, it may be due to senile atrophy of the periurethral glands. Many types of therapies have been tried, but none is successful in these patients. So coming to the treatment of UTI. So while treating a patient of UTI, least toxic, least expensive drug should be used for shortest duration. So in primary care, UTIs are treated empirically. Diagnosis is based on symptoms and confirmed with urine microscopy, and always use a short course of therapy. Short course is effective, it is less toxic, it ensures better compliance, and it also causes less damage to the physiologic flora of the patient. So there is nothing new. The age-old drugs are as effective as they were decades ago. The first-line drugs which are used for treatment of uncomplicated UTIs are fosfomycin, nitrofurantoin, and ceftriaxone. Fluoroquinolones are still considered as a second-line therapy, and they are better reserved for complicated UTIs and upper urinary tract infections. Nitrofurantoin and ceftriaxone and fosfomycin, they have a very low level of resistance even now because they have a narrow spectrum of activity. So in an uncomplicated UTI, lower UTI, single dose of fosfomycin of 3 grams given at bedtime is safe and it is very effective. Only disadvantage is this drug is very expensive. And it is not used in males. It is effective in females. Another second drug which is effective is nitrofurantoin, which is given typically 100 milligram twice a day for 5 days. It is effective against majority of the uropathogens. But 2 points that are noted in the while using nitrofurantoin is that its antimicrobial activity is limited to the urinary tract. It does not achieve good tissue concentration. So this drug is ineffective in the upper urinary tract infection. So whenever there is any suspicion of pyelonephritis, nitrofurantoin should not be used. Second thing, if the patient is having a creatinine clearance of less than 60, if the patient is having renal failure, the drug is practically ineffective because nitrofurantoin will not be secreted into the urine. So drug won't be effective. In my daily clinical practice, I see many patients with a creatinine of 2, 2.5. They have been prescribed nitrofurantoin for the treatment of UTI and patient does not respond and then patient is referred. So whenever the creatinine is more than 1.5, nitrofurantoin is practically not effective for the treatment of UTI and it should not be used. And the third drug that is effective is ceftriaxone. Combination of sulfamethoxazole and trimethoprim, a double strength tablet given twice a day for 3 days is very effective for the treatment of UTI and it is effective against all the pathogens except enterococcus, and the drug should not be used in pregnancy. Fluoroquinolones, all fluoroquinolones are very effective for the treatment of UTI. Short course of 3 days is very effective. They are also effective against upper tract infections as well as complicated infections, but should be avoided in pregnancy. So first line drugs still are fosfomycin, nitrofurantoin and ceftriaxone, and they can be used empirically without sending urine cultures. So coming to asymptomatic bacteriuria, many a times we keep on screening patients for presence of bacteria, and if we find bacteria, we treat these patients. So asymptomatic bacteriuria is presence of significant bacteriuria but in the absence of any clinical symptoms of UTI. So this asymptomatic bacteriuria is very common in certain groups of patients like diabetic patients, elderly patients, patients who have some kind of bladder dysfunction like neurogenic bladder, patients who are on indwelling catheters, and those patients who have suffered spinal cord injuries. These patients will continuously, they will have bacteriuria in the urine, but they will not have any symptoms of UTI. So it is very important to not to treat these patients for UTI because there is no benefit of treating these patients. And the risk is there will be development of resistance to the common antibiotics which are available for the treatment of UTI. So never screen these patients for the presence of asymptomatic bacteriuria. And if asymptomatic bacteriuria is found, it should not be treated. It should be left as such because this is not going to harm the patients and antibiotic therapy is not going to help the patients. Only 3 conditions in which asymptomatic bacteriuria should be treated are: number one is children, because in children, asymptomatic bacteriuria, it leads to the development of scarring of kidneys and future development of hypertension and renal failure. So asymptomatic bacteriuria should always be treated in children. Number two, pregnant woman. In pregnant woman, it should be treated. And number three, those patients who has to undergo some kind of urologic intervention, it should be treated to prevent urosepsis. So in these conditions, asymptomatic bacteriuria should be treated. So coming to relapse and reinfection, So relapse of UTI happens within 3 weeks of antibiotic therapy. It occurs with the same infecting organism, and it is usually due to the either inadequate or due to inappropriate antibiotic therapy, or there is some sequestrated focus of infection either in the prostate in males or in the kidneys. So reinfection is defined as infection occurring more than 3 weeks after the treatment of previous episode. It can be with the same organism or the different organism, and most of the recurrent UTIs are due to reinfection, and it is caused by reintroduction of bacteria from the perineal flora. So recurrent UTI is defined as at least 2 episodes of uncomplicated cystitis within a 6-month period, or at least 3 episodes in a 12-month period. So we commonly see in our day-to-day practice that recurrent UTIs are very, very common among young healthy women in the absence of any anatomic functional abnormalities of the urogenital tract, and these females are genetically predisposed to the development of recurrent UTIs. While in men, recurrent UTIs are very uncommon, and if we find any male with recurrent UTIs, it is likely that he might be having some associated abnormalities of the urinary tract. So these are the table shows what are the risk factors that predispose women to the recurrent UTIs. So this is the treatment strategy for handling a patient with the recurrent UTIs. In females, there is a correlation of recurrent UTIs with the sexual intercourse. So in these patients, we advise a post-coital single dose prophylaxis, which can be given either with nitrofurantoin or a ceftriaxone. So those patients who experience less frequent episodes like 2 UTIs per year, they can be prescribed self-administered short course therapy like nitrofurantoin or a ceftriaxone for 3 days. While third category of patient who experiences more than 2 UTIs in a year, they should be given continuous low dose prophylaxis, and the drugs most commonly used are the nitrofurantoin and ceftriaxone, because these 2 drugs are highly effective against all the uropathogens, and number 2, emergence of the resistance against these 2 drugs is very, very low. So norfloxacin can also be used, but it should preferably be avoided because of the risk of development of resistance. The duration of prophylaxis is 6 months, but patients frequently develop again UTI once the prophylaxis is stopped, and sometimes prophylaxis has to be extended for several years. So there are some adjuvant measures other than the antibiotics that can help to prevent the recurrent UTIs. We should advise adequate fluid intake and regular voiding, because it helps in flushing the bacteria out of the bladder. In those patients who have a correlation with the sexual intercourse, they should immediately void after the sexual intercourse. And those females who have who are using spermicides, they should use alternate methods of contraception, because these spermicides, they tend to alter the normal vaginal flora. And in postmenopausal women, replacement with the topical estrogen creams, they have been shown to reduce the episode of recurrent UTIs. So we have heard a lot of hype about the use of cranberry juice. It's also available in the form of tablets and capsules. The active ingredient are the proanthocyanidins, and the mechanism that has been proposed is that it causes acidification of urine and inhibits the bacterial proliferation, and number 2, it reduces the adhesion of the uropathogenic bacteria to the uroepithelial cells. But randomized controlled trials, they have failed to show any significant benefit on reduction of recurrence of UTIs. So this cranberry juice, tablets, capsules, they are practically ineffective in causing any reduction in the recurrence of UTIs. So now a few words about UTI in pregnancy. Asymptomatic bacteriuria is very common, and if left untreated, it may lead to development of pyelonephritis. So pyelonephritis, if it happens in pregnancy, it is associated with significant fetal morbidity in terms of low birth weight. So all pregnant patients, they should be screened for bacteriuria at their first antenatal visit, and if asymptomatic bacteriuria is found, it should be treated. So these are the drugs which are considered safe in pregnancy. We can use nitrofurantoin, we can use penicillins like amoxicillin, we can use cephalosporins like cefpodoxime and cefixime, we can use ceftriaxone. The points to be noted are nitrofurantoin and ceftriaxone should not be used in first and last trimester of pregnancy. Both of these drugs are safe in mid trimester of pregnancy, while penicillins and cephalosporins are safe throughout the pregnancy. And treatment is given for 5 to 7 days. So acute pyelonephritis, if it is a complicated acute pyelonephritis, it should be referred to the specialist for management. Uncomplicated pyelonephritis can be treated on OPD basis. Urine culture should always be stent before starting the antibiotic therapy. And patient of uncomplicated pyelonephritis should respond within a period of 48 to 72 hours. And if the patient is not responding within this period, then it is an indication for to do the further imaging, maybe ultrasound or CT scan of the kidneys to rule out any obstruction or any other complicating factors. And duration of therapy will be 7 to 10 days if we are using quinolones and 14 days if we are using cephalosporins. So few words about the Ferropenem. None of the guidelines about management of UTIs mention Ferropenem. So this drug was made available more than a decade ago, and since then there is a rampant use, at least in the Asian subcontinent. It is not US FDA approved for any of the indications so far. So it is a broad spectrum orally active carbapenem, which is active against gram positive, gram negative bacteria, both aerobic and anaerobic. But it is not effective against methicillin resistant staph, vancomycin resistant enterococcus and pseudomonas. It is not US FDA approved, but off label use is very, very common. So I would like to say that we should restrict the use of Ferropenem in uncomplicated lower UTIs when we have a simpler drugs to manage these UTIs, because Ferropenem use can lead to development of cross resistance to other classes of carbapenems like imipenem, meropenem, doripenem, and carbapenems are the only higher antibiotics that are currently available for the management of serious infections. So Ferropenem should not be used for the management of uncomplicated lower UTIs. We can consider it like switching the patients from IV to oral therapy in pyelonephritis and limit its use as far as possible. So I would conclude my presentation with key points are UTIs are the most common bacterial infections. So whenever we see a patient of UTI, try to identify if it is upper versus lower, if it is complicated or uncomplicated. So uncomplicated can be simply diagnosed with symptoms and urine microscopy. Urine culture is not necessary. Differentiate UTI from other causes of urethritis and vaginitis with careful history, because these conditions require a different type of therapy. Always treat with a short course of simple antibiotics like nitrofurantoin, ceftriaxone, and if this patient is not tolerating these drugs, you may use fluoroquinolones. Do not screen for asymptomatic bacteriuria. Do not treat patients with asymptomatic bacteriuria, and refer cases of complicated UTIs to the specialists for management. So these are the drugs that are used for the pyelonephritis, and we are all aware of this. So thank you all for your kind attention.
Thank you so much, ma'am. In the next line, we have Dr. Diljit Singh Tillon, MS ENT Consultant, Tillon ENT Center.